Friends, today is Pentecost Sunday, and I think you can see the colors have changed from the white to the red color. And red is the color of fire, and it's the fire of Pentecost. It's the color of the Holy Spirit, because it's also today that we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the church, which makes it the church's birthday. And red is also the color of blood, because the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. And so today we celebrate Pentecost Sunday. So let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Lord, would you just open our hearts and minds that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. In the name of Christ, amen. I invite you to read together the passage from Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like a rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and were bewildered because each one of them heard them speaking in the native tongue of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Parthians, okay, maybe a different group, Medes, Elamites, the residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, and we hear them speaking about God's great deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said they were filled with new wine. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.'" This is the word of the Lord. You know, very often we think that if God were to use anyone for important task, it will be somebody who is very important. The high-class, multi-talented people, maybe people from MGS and ACS, you know, the more upper crust rather than ordinary people. And then sometimes in the church, when we want to emphasize the importance of our ministry, we get successful people to boost our attraction power. So, you know, you get CEOs or ministers or MPs to be guests of honor, some world-famous scientists to come and give a talk, or some champion sportsman and sportswoman. But you know, the funny thing is, if you look at Scripture, God's choices tend to be people who are weak and people who are very often broken people. Simon Peter, who denied Jesus, the guy with the hot temper. Moses, who was a failure and a murderer. When he was in his 80s, then he was called to serve the Lord. Mary Magdalene, who was supposed to be a woman of questionable morals. Mary, the mother of Jesus, who was only 14 years old when, you know, she gave birth to Jesus, because that's the age of mothers in those days. John, one of the sons of Zebedee with very hot temper, and who has probably some issues with, you know, competition with each other, with other people in the family as well as amongst the disciples. Then you've got people like King David, you know. King David was an adulterer. Ruth, who was a Moabite, somebody from a different race. Naomi, who was quite bitter and an old widow. Joseph, a yaya guy, you know, very young, very yaya until the Lord had to train him. Saul, who was a persecutor of the Christians, and later on he became known as Paul when he converted. John Mark was a failed missionary. After the first trip, he decided to give up. And yet the Lord used them. You see, sometimes when we look at the disciples in the upper room, waiting for Pentecost, we've got a very romantic picture of them. We think, you know, they must be so excited, waiting for the power from on high to come, as Jesus promised. But, you know, the reality is that they're probably very uncertain and unsure. They were a broken community. And, you know, first you have 12 disciples, then minus one, minus Judas. And then there were 11, and then they quickly got another one in, Matthias, to make 12, so that there will be the historic theological number of 12. And they were not neither here nor there. Sometimes we think that they've got it together after the resurrection of Christ, but no, they were probably unsure, they were traumatized. I think all of you know when you've gone through a trauma that your stomach's sort of shaking, and after a few days it's still shaking. It's not like, you know, suddenly you can get over it. They've undergone great stress. They've seen the arrest, crucifixion, resurrection, ascension. Some of it is good, some of it not very good. And it's very frightening, some of the things that they went through. Unexpected changes in everything. And the people who were gathered there in the upper room, as well as the people that we read in the whole lot of Parthians and whatever, they were mostly conquered people by Rome. They were not people who were up in the top rank of society. They were people with shattered dreams. You see, the disciples for 3 years, they had followed Jesus and they were hoping for a nationalistic kingdom. And then Jesus died. Okay, he rose again. But it sounds like their nationalistic kingdom isn't going to come about. Now what? You know, that's uncertain future. There's also this broken leadership structure. You know, Jesus, in those days after the resurrection, he sort of popped in and appeared and suddenly he disappeared. So they don't know what to expect. And then who's the leader of the group? There's Peter, the loudmouthed one, but he's so unstable, he just denied Christ. How can we ever trust him? He just denied Christ about a few weeks ago, they would say. And yet, God's unusual choice is that he tends to use broken vessels. If we look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, it says, we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that this life may also be revealed in our mortal bodies. It's talking about our fragile, weakness kind of character, but yet God uses us. In 2 Corinthians, Paul says, the Lord said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest in me. And basically, he says, when I am weak, then I am strong. And in 1 Corinthians, it says that God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chooses the lowly things of the world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are so that no one may boast before him. If anyone wants to boast, let them boast in the Lord. What it's saying to us is that God chooses people who are not perfect, people who are not up on the top. He chooses broken people. And what we notice in the scriptures is that broken people or broken vessels are desperate people. Maybe that's why God can use us. Because where there's no crisis, there's no change, yeah? If everything just goes smoothly, there's no reason for changing anything. But when there's crisis, then there is a reason to change. And more so, if you're down, there's nowhere to go but up. Unless you want to go further down. You know, what is interesting in the Methodist movement is that John Wesley started many small groups. And he had a group of people called the penitent bands. The penitent band members are those who have sinned. and sinned badly. So he gathered them together to support each other to grow towards holiness. And what scholars have found is that many in the penitent bands actually became members of the Select Society. Select Society is the group of mature Christians who are growing very greatly in faith. You see, those people who have hit rock bottom are the desperate ones whom the Lord can use to grow in a deeper way. The second thing about people who are broken is that they tend to have experienced the grace of God, and therefore they are filled with grace and are giving grace to others. We read that in the story of Zacchaeus in the Bible. We know the story of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector in the region. He became very rich. But tax collectors in those days are seen as people who work with the authorities, the Roman authorities. They betray their own people, and also they line their own pockets with money that's not supposed to be theirs. And he wanted to see Jesus, and he was up this sycamore tree, and Jesus came by and he said, "Zacchaeus, quick, come down. I must be a guest at your home today." And Zacchaeus quickly jumped down and went to his house in great excitement and joy, because suddenly this guy accepted him. Everybody was upset, you know, Jesus has gone to the house of the sinner. But Jesus said, "No, this man is still a son of Abraham." And he says, "Zacchaeus, who received grace, says, I will give half my wealth to the poor, and if I've cheated people in their taxes, I will give them back four times as much." That's no mean amount. That's a lot, which means he is near bankrupt in doing all that. But you see, Jesus says, salvation has come to this home today, because something has happened in Zacchaeus' life. He has experienced grace, and therefore is forgiving and forgiven. People who have experienced grace will extend grace to others and change their lives. They're willing to pay the price. And sometimes the price can be very high, because Jesus says that if you want to plant anything, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it will not bear fruit. And people who are broken are willing to let go, are willing to be sacrificed, as it were. You know, in Acts 1:8, we read the passage. Every time we read it, we tend to read it very triumphantly, you know, that the Spirit of God will come upon you and you will be my witnesses, blah, blah, blah. And we think that the disciples were thinking, "Oh, good, we have the power." Like, you know, we've got the energy. But, you know, listen to the words. Jesus says, "As the Father has sent me, so send I you." Where did the Father send him? To the cross. If the Father sent him to the cross, where would he send us? To the cross. Lagi teruk. Hey, this is not something to get too excited about. "And then you will be my witnesses." Today we think witnesses, well, nice word, nah. But witness means martyr. It's the same word in Greek. The word witness means martyr. And be my witness, not only in Jerusalem, but in Judea, Samaria, uttermost parts of the world, which means nowhere to run. I mean, is this a great promise? Scary. But they were willing to give all because they have received much. I think many of us have one of our favorite hymns, Amazing Grace. But the guy who wrote Amazing Grace had a very checkered past, John Newton. He himself was abused, and he was an abuser, he was a slave trader. And because of what he has experienced in his life, he can come up with a hymn like Amazing Grace. How great this love and grace of God is, because he has experienced it, and he's willing to pay the price in his life in serving the Lord. So what we have said so far is broken people, usually God chooses them, they are desperate, they have experienced grace, and they are willing to pay the price. If you want one word to summarize that, it means that they are open people. But note, broken people can be open people. It doesn't necessarily mean they are, because many of us are broken people, and sometimes broken people are not necessarily very open. We can focus so much on ourselves that we can be bitter and closed. And when we are bitter and closed, what happens? I think you remember the old Beatles song that says, "I am a rock feels no pain, and an island never cries." We close in onto ourselves, or be a robot, no feelings, no nothing. Or we can hurt other people. Broken people can hurt other people. Because we are so used to being abused, we can abuse other people, and we can make it very difficult for people around us. Sometimes we can use brokenness as a crutch. You know, this victim mentality, feel entitled, poor me. I did this, but, you know, poor me. And then it becomes very self-absorbed. Nobody will listen to me. Please listen to me. I hate myself. This is too much for me. Everything is about me. You see, one thing that turns broken people into people whom God cannot use is when they turn towards themselves. Sometimes we use brokenness as a badge of honor, and this is a bit insidious. It becomes a marketable identity. Some weeks ago, I saw on Facebook something that preacher Wendy posted on Facebook, and it got me to think. She quoted from Anthony de Mello, where a disciple comes to the teacher and says, "I've come with you with nothing in my hands." And the master says, "Drop it at once." He says, "But how can I drop? It's nothing, nothing in my hands. What do I drop?" Then he says, "Then carry it along with you. Your nothing can be your most valuable possession." You see, what happens is, sometimes we think there's nothing. I don't have anything I'm carrying, but actually, it's pride and identity that I have nothing. It's kind of insidious, that I have nothing. Or I am an X, this or that. That can be a pride and identity. There's nothing wrong in being, I'm X this, I'm X that, you know, ex-prisoner, ex-drug addict, ex-adulterer, whatever it is. Fine, you are giving testimony to the Lord, but if year after year that's the thing that you wear, that becomes an identity, then there's a bit something wrong. I'm an abused person, we say, and then we wear that as an identity because the focus is again on self. You see, the trick is that whenever we focus on ourselves, we turn backwards. It's the wrong place for identity to be grounded, and we are stuck to the past. Learn to turn towards other people. When broken people turn towards other people, they become whole in Christ. Because if you look at the story in Pentecost, you get people like John and Peter and Thomas who don't get along with each other necessarily. They're so different. John, the meditative one, Peter, the abrasive and the outgoing one, Thomas, the doubter who thinks too much. Then you've got women in the upper room as well. You've got older people like Mary in the upper room too. Old and young, people of different characters, they were all one in one accord. And when we read the passage just now of Peter preaching, it says that the other disciples were standing with him. They were agreeing with him in it. Unity. So you have people who are slave and free, young and old, male and female. They are together waiting for the promise of the Father. They are willing to be inclusive, to say we are part of the family. It's not just me and my group, me and my cell group, me and my gang, but me as part of this community of faith. Only then would we be able to be used by God and receive the promise of the Father, because they were there in one accord. And maybe the 40 days was waiting for them to be all in one accord. Because if they were not in one accord, the Spirit of God wouldn't come. And they learned also to focus on God, willing not to be in control of the situation. It says in verse 2, there was a sound of the blowing of a violent wind. You see that kind of experience in Ezekiel, in Philip, in the Bible, where it's very physical and very unpredictable encounter with the Spirit of God, and manifesting in signs and wonders. And the willingness not to be in control and to allow Him to work with us, to cooperate with Him. And there was this gift of tongues. The gift of tongues basically says, it doesn't all depend on me to learn, you know, languages through whatever, linguaphone or whatever it is. Because the passage says, as the Spirit gives them utterance. So they have to open their mouth to make noise first, and the Spirit makes sense of the word. So there is this willingness to be open to God, open to each other, and then it's a new day, a new experience, open to new experiences. Because in the Bible, we see people encountering God through angels, through prophets, through Jesus. But here is something that's totally unexpected, not even like burning bush. It's never in history that God encountered his people like this on Pentecost, the willingness to experience new things. It's like in Romans 8, where it says in the Message version, God's Spirit beckons. There are things to do and places to go. This resurrection life you receive from God is not a timid, grave-tending life. It is adventurously expecting, greeting God with a child like, what's next, Papa? It's a willingness to move with God. And only then can we see Pentecost come. Only then can we see a reversal. And Pentecost is seen as the reversal of the Tower of Babel that you read in Genesis 11. The Tower of Babel is when people wanted to be united and they wanted to build this tower that reaches to the sky to make a name for themselves. And the result was that God divided them, giving them different languages. In Acts 2, where we talk about Pentecost, God heals the divided people of the world and pulls them together. And you see the difference. Babel, they were focused on themselves, their survival and their glory, whereas in Pentecost, they were focused on God and in unity with one another. In Babel's story, people couldn't understand each other and they were scattered and separated, and that was the end of it all. Whereas in Pentecost, people understood each other beyond languages and they were united and brought together for the kingdom of God. You see, God loves to use crackpots, and some of us are crackpots, to transform us into healing channels. What we have said so far is God uses broken vessels, because broken vessels, broken people, can be desperate enough to be open, experience grace, and therefore can extend grace, willing to pay the price. But if we focus on ourselves, then the opposite happens. God can't use us. We can be bitter, we hurt others, we feel entitled and play victim card, we can be prideful. And Pentecost is when we focus on other people, be inclusive, focus on God, willingness not to be in control, willing to let God open the future. And then they can be channels of God's healing in the broken world. And now we look at the application. How does this apply to us? Are we broken people? I think if we look at our lives, many of us are broken in some way or other. And if we are at a state where we are feeling comfortable, in a good life, like everything, no crisis, no change, then it's status quo, nothing will happen because we are there. And sometimes there's this resistance to change because we are too comfortable. You know, one of the things that I've been feeling quite sad about regarding this church is that we are smack in the middle of this place called One North. And One North has grown over the years. It's grown very massively over the years in terms of all the industries that have come around us. And the question is, who's going to reach them? We are the nearest church, and we are not doing much. We've got the AMC Marketplace Ministries, but how many of these people there at this recent meeting that I was at, how many of them belong to our church? Some of you are working around there. Why don't you join the Marketplace Ministry and help Liang Chiang's team to reach out? We've got only about 5 people from there who are from our church. There is a need for us to reach out to the people there. And so it requires change. It requires the willingness to unite with people not like us to serve God's kingdom. Brokenness comes, not sometimes. Sometimes we think brokenness comes through some external crisis, but sometimes it comes through the willingness to have eyes to see and hearts to feel. Until our hearts and our minds are broken by the sight of pain that God feels towards what is broken in the world, we cannot be broken people who have the heart of God. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 4, it says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." And it's kind of funny because the word mourn means to weep for those who have died. But what it basically means is blessed are those who can feel pain, the pain of God and the pain of others, that they will be strengthened. Comforted means to be strengthened, not to be, sayang, sayang, don't worry, but to be strengthened to move out. The gift of brokenness, because God speaks to us about his heart. He will give us a new heart and new spirit. He will remove the heart of stone, give us hearts of flesh. Are we willing to be broken people for him in our hearts? And then we can say, with Isaiah, when he hears the word, who shall I send? Who will go for us? He says, here am I. Send me. And that's what they said at Pentecost, because something happened to them. They have gone through trauma. They were broken people. God used them. But some of them began to see, perhaps, what God sees through that experience, the pain of the broken world. Broken people are generally like this. Am I desperate enough to move in the next level, confident that His grace, which I have experienced, is real and can flow through me to whatever situation He sends me? Am I willing to be desperate, very hungry? Am I willing to be a broken person for Him? And as a broken person, perhaps we look at our lives and we say, I'm actually very focused on myself. I'm broken, I'm closed, I'm hurtful to others. I play the victim card, and sometimes I wear it as an identity so that I get open doors because I say I was an abused person, I was this, I was that, I'm a victim. Is it not time, perhaps, to receive healing? A time to repent? A time to allow Him to do a new thing in our lives? If Pentecost is a time when God does a new thing, help us to focus on others, focus on Him, and let God open the future. Which of the above do I need to grow in the coming months? Some of these questions are in your bulletin. Please look at them. And our prayer is, may broken vessels become His healing channels. May crackpots like us become His serving dishes. And may this be our prayer for today. I invite you to pray. I can't get over, Lord, how often in the pages of your word you've told of using broken things in working miracles. The boy's 5 loaves of bread broken fed a multitude. A roof your disciples broke up to lower that poor palsied man into your presence. The pitchers carried by the men that Gideon led. The pitchers broken that the lamps within could then shine and implement a victory. And to the alabaster box which Mary broke in order to release its fragrance as she worshipped at your feet. You've spoken to my heart, Lord, through your use of broken things. And now somehow I feel that brokenness of heart, of will, must be the starting point if you would work a miracle through me. And so break me. Break me to feed a multitude your word, to bring the ill in heart into your presence. Shine in victory from my life and send forth fragrance in praise of you. In the name of Christ.